Blackstone Audiobooks presents Chloe by Lynn Cote. To my agent, Danielle Egan Miller. Thanks for all your hard work and for having confidence in me. You've been great. Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me. Charlotte Elliott. Part 1. Chapter 1. Tidewater, Maryland, April 1917. Chloe thought dying would be easier than what her father wanted her to do now. She'd just been lifted onto the open bed of a farm truck, where she gazed out from under the low brim of her straw hat. It framed the terrifying jumble of faces gawking up at her. "Chloe?" Her father's voice rumbled a warning. Barrel-chested, wearing a custom-tailored suit, he hovered beside the truck fender while she stood above him, trembling. She parted her lips, desperate for air, as all the faces ran together like wet watercolors. "Chloe?" her father repeated, chilling her. She tried to think of the words that would please her father and also sway the people before her, but under her cream lace bodice, she couldn't inflate her lungs. It was as if her corset had been laced too high and much too tight. She tried to focus on the scene before her, the smell of fecund earth buffeted upward in warm waves. The dazzling, nearly blinding spring sunshine glinted off the chrome of Model T cars and trucks, amidst a few old wagons and horses tethered here and there. She managed to draw in a teaspoon of the warm afternoon air.
"Chloe,"
her father prompted, his raw irritation bristling just under the surface.
"Chloe! Chloe!"
Out in the crowd, a tall, tow-headed boy called out her name and followed it up with a loud wolf whistle. An older man beside him cuffed the boy as a few chuckles and titters floated up to her, taunting her.
"I can't do this, I can't."
"You can do anything."
A clear, loud voice sliced through her mind. Startled, her lungs found space to expand. Chloe sucked in air and hefted the megaphone to her mouth.
"I've never done this before."
Her voice came out unnatural and hollow-sounding. She swallowed, trying to wet her cut-and-dry mouth.
"You can do anything you put your mind to, and don't let nobody tell you different."
The plucky words gave her sudden confidence. Chloe lowered the megaphone.
"I don't think I need this," she said in a loud voice.
She forced a smile.
"Can y'all hear me?"
And she started to breathe. As from far away, approving murmurs from the watching crowd rippled up in reply. Men wearing denim overalls and straw hats slouched against blossoming trees, scant protection from the warm sunlight. Under the trees, women in starched print house dresses lounged primly on worn quilts where babies slept. Beside the schoolhouse, vacant on Saturday afternoon, barefoot children raced from the wooden swings to the slide and back again. Their yells and laughter drifted up to Chloe. Still, Chloe felt their eyes boring holes into her. Her father fidgeted. She sucked in air again.
"My daddy asked me to talk to you today,"
she blurted out the truth.
"I really don't know why."
But that was as near as could be to a lie.
"I'm here to turn everyone up sweet for Daddy. I knew something was up the minute I clapped eyes on the new clothes he brought home from D.C.
The cream-colored cotton jackanet dress with its stylish, narrow skirt and high waist, the matching silk stockings, butter-soft kid shoes and gloves, had made her edgy, not pleased.
"You'll be coming with me,"
he'd said before he'd left this morning's breakfast table, and she'd felt herself shrivel inside. Now she strangled the megaphone with both hands, as if she could choke words out of it.
"But maybe it's 'cause I know him better than anyone else."
Another lie. Or was it? The crowd looked interested. They waited. Then she realized it had been her granny's long-dead voice in her mind, urging her on, showing her how to talk to these folk. Her beloved granny, the one person who had always made Chloe feel loved and valuable in her own right. This thought gave her courage.
"My granny Rainey,"
her voice gained weight,
"always told me,
You can do anything you make your mind up to. Just look at your daddy.
Truth at last.
She heard her father's chortle of approval. She sensed the man in the crowd listening to her. Her jittery heart still lodged in her throat, but somehow she spoke around it, striving to appear confident.
My daddy wasn't born in a big house like we live in now.
Phrases from speeches she'd heard her father give over the years filtered through her nervous mind and out through her lips.
He didn't get to go to college. He taught himself law. He passed the bar and became a district attorney. Then he ran and won a seat in the state legislature.
What next?
She recalled the morning's headline and grabbed at it. In this dangerous time of the war to end all wars, he wants to serve you as your first elected senator in Washington, D.C.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.